Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. Today, we're running the first Moodle Academy webinar of 2024 about generative AI and H5P. I am Sandra Matz, Moodle Academy Educational Events Coordinator here at Moodle HQ. My colleague, Mary Kutch, Education Manager from the Moodle Academy team, is also joining me today and will help facilitate the webinar. Today, we are delighted to welcome Svein-Tore Griff, the founder of H5P, to take us through the process of creating H5P content in a fraction of the time it used to take with the help of generative AI. Svein-Tore will demonstrate how you can create fully fledged interactive courses in minutes with H5P. So over to you, Svein-Tore, and thank you for joining us today.
Thanks a lot, and I'm very excited to be here and showing you how we can make content creation a lot faster with tools like ChatGPT and other large language models. I'll be sharing my screen now. I'm very happy that so many people were interested in this topic, and I hope you'll walk away from this session with some knowledge that you can put to use right away. That is the goal. So hopefully you're already familiar with H5P. I won't say a lot about H5P, but I'll focus on showing you how AI tools can be used in combination with H5P to get new ideas and build content very quickly. The vision of H5P is very important to us, though. We want to empower everyone to create, share, and reuse interactive content. And this means rich, it means poor, it means people with disabilities, people in all over the world. And our goal is that it should be very, very easy for people to build content and also very, very easy for people to share their content with others. So we're very happy that H5P is part of Moodle Core, makes the future of H5P very safe. Should something happen with my company who created H5P, H5P will still be around. It's a very safe format to build your interactive content in. And also Moodle makes it available for both rich universities and large school systems in developing countries globally. So that's our vision. Make it very, very easy to collaborate on interactive content. And then when we let H5P meet AI, things can be done a lot faster, which kind of boosts our vision more, or our progress towards the vision. It's much easier to build rich content than it has been before when you can do it with AI. And what do we achieve by this? I think we can build content we've never been able to build before. So we've been dreaming about having these adaptive content for learners. You can send the same content to one learner, and the content will adapt to that learner. It can show the material in a more visual way, a more experimental way. It can do tests, it can do hard tests, easy tests. It can really adapt to the learner, and building that is possible without AI, of course. It's just so costly, so time consuming that you very rarely see it. I think with AI we will see more and more of that really, really high end content. We also see courses let's say a chemistry course. You might have interactive content for 10% of the course and you would want to have it for 100%, but you don't have the time to build it. So hopefully with AI we can cover the content with the interactive content in a much better way. And there is plenty of research that tells us that if the content is interactive, people will remember it much better, understand it much better. It will be much more engaging. And maybe we can also see some more data-driven education. Use AI to analyze the data we get from the content and use it to improve the content so that the content will be better and better and better automatically. So hopefully in the end, this will give us better learning content and then better education. So what can AI do for us? We'll look at it today, some of it. It can assist in creating drafts. Not good enough yet to just push the button and then give whatever the AI comes up with to students, but it can certainly help us speed things up, create good drafts. And we just spend a fraction of the time reviewing the content instead of building it all ourselves. And we can focus on the most creative content. Let the AI handle the more mundane tasks. If we are running out of ideas, higher order learning, for instance, AI can be used for that as well to come up with project ideas for us. And it can also be used to improve things that we've built, improve the language or make things more or less sophisticated, etc. And again, very important to remember, AI is not good enough to just trust it. It's very tempting. If you're busy, just use an AI tool, create learning material for the next day and jump into the bathtub. But we have to look through it and make sure that it's good quality. It does what we intended to do. There are no mistakes and the level is correct, etc. So that's a little intro to H5P and AI. H5P lends itself very well to AI because the data is very separated from the design and very separated from the functionality. The data is very clean in H5P, and I think that is why we're seeing lots of startups and companies now who build AI tools for H5P. I know there's a Moodle plugin coming as well that will help us build really large resources using AI and H5P together. We are going to look at an example of that built by my team also at the end there. But first now, we're going to look at how we can use AI tool directly at AI chat like ChatGPT to build H5P content. So the first thing we are going to look at is single choice set. So here we, and you can go to this page yourself, hpp.org/AI/Moodle to find all these recipes and try them out yourself later. So here we have prompts and we have screenshots from the editor. This is mostly to benefit you if you try this yourself and the end result. So I'm going to show you now if we take this prompt. And you see that some of the text here is in bold. Those parts are those that you're most likely want to change in this prompt. So the subject, the Northern Lights, you might want to change it. And also the number of questions and alternatives you might want to change. So we'll copy this text now. And I go to ChatGPT. And I paste in the prompt. And we'll just run the normal one first. And now ChatGPT will create content that we can just paste directly into H5P and get a single choice set out of it. So this is all we had to do to get a single choice set about Northern Lights. We can copy it. And we can go into H5P. Single choice set. And this is the little trick. So many of the H5P content types have this textual mode. And that is what we're going to do to use to create the content. So I pasted in what I got from ChatGPT. And when I save it, we have got our single choice set. So you can do it super quick. Build single choice set very quickly. And then I'm going to show you just some ideas of how you may change the prompt. We'll experiment a little. So we'll spend a little bit more time on this example than the following ones, just to give you some ideas. So the same prompt again, but now maybe I want to make this for children in kindergarten. So create a multiple choice quiz about the Northern Lights. The target audience is, let's say, 5-year-old children. And we just need three questions and three alternatives per question. And obviously we can add a lot more instructions here if we want to. That's the really, really nice thing about doing it this way. You have absolute full control. You can add as many instructions as you want. And I'm sure many of us have been using ChatGPT and other tools and are quite familiar with writing prompts already. So here you can be creative. You just have to make sure that you keep these last instructions there that tells the tool how to structure the output. One other thing that is nice to know is that if you add lots of instructions, ChatGPT tend to start ignoring things randomly. So if you add too many instructions, it might start messing up the format, then it won't be as easy to just paste it in. But you have to add quite a few instructions for that to happen. Okay, let's see how this works. So I think the first question here, I'm not sure if my 5-year-old would know the answer, but the next one is much more kid-friendly. And also the third one is quite kid-friendly. So you see that it is it's changing a lot based on me providing the target audience. Okay. And then we'll go to the next example, which is summary. So quite similar, but another content type. Interactive summary is actually one of my favorites because it's very, very nice to put at the end of a session or at the end of reading a chapter or something like that.
Just a quick question, Svein. Someone is asking, you're using ChatGPT. Does the workflow work with other AI platforms, Copilot, Bard?
Yeah, I don't know Copilot, but we tested a bit in Bard. I think we had to adjust the prompts a little bit to get the right format, but they do work with other platforms. Yeah, so use your favorite platform and you might adjust a little bit. We're using GPT now since it's the most well-known and popular. And this is actually interesting because I had tested this earlier and got the perfect format. We are updating our recipes constantly, because the interesting thing about ChatGPT is that it won't respond the same way to prompts every time. It keeps changing, and we have to update our prompts to make sure it still works. So this output actually doesn't have the correct format anymore. But it's nice to know. It's been a continuous battle with them. If you build AI tools also, they can suddenly stop working because ChatGPT changes how it responds to a prompt. But I'll will build a summary anyway. Awesome. So here with interactive summary, it is similar. You have this textual mode where you can paste in the text from ChatGPT. And what is wrong here is that we asked it to only have empty lines between the sets of statements. And it did that last time, but now it has added empty lines between every statement instead. So we asked it to write five correct statements. And the first statement is always correct, followed by three destructor statements, no labels, etc. So now I have to format it myself. And remove some of these empty lines. This is one set, this is the next one. And when we are done here, I'm going to try to figure out how I can make it not add all these empty lines. I think this is how it should have been. And we save, still quick. And now we get this interactive statements, which is a really, 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 if you are tempted to write a summary at the end of something, consider interactive summary instead, because then you can have the students think a little and they'll kind of be building their summary instead of you just giving it to them. So they'll learn a lot more from it and they will still have a nice summary at the end. One instruction that is also tempting to give ChatGPT is to make sure it doesn't always make the correct answer the longest. So if you give it that instruction, it won't always be the correct one that is the longest. And it's a mistake we humans tend to do as well when we build multiple choice questions. But yes, this is how you can do it with summary. And the last one I'll show you is drag the words, so it's a bit different. So here we're going to do Northern Lights again, and but in the drag the words format, and we're also going to have ChatGPT create some feedback for us. When we build interactive content, if we are able to provide feedback as well, there's a lot more learning from it. But it is also very time consuming. So having in multiple choice, you can do the same. You can program in feedback if they chose an incorrect answer and explain why that answer was incorrect. But doing so very time consuming, and it's something that we can have the AI do for us, and we just review the suggestion. So here we have it create three paragraphs, 3 to 7 drop balls per paragraph, and add explanations. And we tell it which format to use. So let's see what we get. So now it starts writing some paragraphs about Northern Lights, and it add draggable words automatically. And this is the third example, but it's also nice for you to know that H5P has many more content types where you can paste in text, fill in the blanks, for instance, the quiz content type, find the word, or what is it called? There is one content type at least where you're supposed to click on, for instance, all the verbs in a sentence. GPT will be able to create content for all of those content types for you automatically. So it is very powerful. And we'll get to see the result of this one very soon. One of the tricks that I'm using in all of these prompts is output the answer as pre-formatted code. So if you want to play around yourself without following the recipes, that one is very nice to add, because if you don't have it, the stars, the asterisks here, tend to turn things into bold and the asterisks go away. So if you add that sentence, it's much easier to get the format that you want. And this one looks like having the correct format, so I'll copy it. And we'll go here and we'll add, drag the words. Northern Lights again. And this time you don't have to go into textual mode. Drag the words is already textual. So we just paste in what we got from GPT here. And we can save and we can see how it turned out. So now we built a drag the words task very, very, very quickly with the help of GPT. The Northern Lights, also known as the Aurora Borealis, are natural light display in the Earth sky, predominantly seen in the high latitude regions around the Arctic and the Antarctic. These lights are a result of disturbances in the magnetosphere caused by solar wind, I think. And I'll just fill in the rest randomly. And then we'll get to see how this turns out. So we'll submit. And here we see we got the first part correct. And there is also feedback here on all the answers. Not all of it is super good, so we would have to go in and change it as authors, some of these feedbacks, and others we can keep. It does help us save a bit of time, and obviously on all of these we can add much more instructions to get more exactly the content we want. Okay, so that was drag the words. The last thing I'm going to show you is a bit different. So again, we have seven more, and we'll probably update this page with recipes for fill in the blanks, etc. also, so that people can use that. The last thing I'll show you is where we built a tool for which uses GPT in the background to create interactive content. So what I'm going to do now is take a couple of YouTube videos, and we're going to turn them into interactive videos. I'm going to do one with large language models. And while I do that, please suggest some topics in the chat that you want me to try to find a video for and turn into an interactive book, interactive session. So if anyone has any ideas on topics, just type them into the chat and I'll pick a random one.
Going to describe.
So first, this large language model. I copy the URL to this video. And we go to, this is something that's the tool we're building now is quite costly to run. We only have it on h5p.com so far. So I took the YouTube link, I paste it in here in what we call smart import. And we start importing the video into H5P, and I'll be going into the chat.
We've got a suggestion of TED, T-E-D, Ed videos. We've got a suggestion of business meetings, by the way, for YouTube so far.
Okay, cool.
Biomechanics, wow.
What was the last one? Biomechanics.
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 Yeah.
I don't know what it is, so that's only the
Me neither, so that sounds a good one.
Yeah. Let's see if we find something fairly short here. The AI will take longer if the content is long. So typically if it is 14 minutes, it will take 7 minutes to do. We have a very short one there, maybe a bit too short, but let's try it. 124.
So am I.
Biomechanics. So I'll copy that one as well, and we'll paste it in here. In smart import, biomechanics. Maybe we learn something new about biomechanics as well today. So while the AI is transcribing these two videos, this is the process. We upload something. So we could have uploaded a video file or a PDF or a Word file, for instance. We could have just pasted in text. We could have added a link to Wikipedia or some other web page, but now we did a YouTube video. And then we review the transcription in the next step. Then the AI will work on finding the central concepts in the content, and we get to review if we agree these are the most important concepts. And the last thing that happens is that the AI will suggest content types for us, and we get to choose what to build. Do we want interactive book, crosswords, etc. So that's how it works. And now we have both of these ready with transcripts. Oh, this was super short. I'm not sure how much we'll be getting out of it, but we'll try. We it's even too short for the AI, so I'll just come up with something. We'll do a little trick here and copy the sentence just to make it long enough. So we probably won't get a lot of questions, etc., for that little video, but we'll try. And then we have large language models. So here we have plenty of content. I'm not going to go through and read it all now. We've been using this example before. And now the AI is analyzing both of them, trying to find the most central concepts. We have done a large language model before, as I said, and this is how it what it looks like when it's done analyzing and finding some concepts. So here you can see architecture, data, etc. Architecture can be many things, but we also see that the AI has understood that it is in the context of large language model, not buildings, for instance. Yeah, training similarly. And all of these, I think, make sense for an interactive resource about large language models. So I'll just continue it. When it comes to biomechanics, the concepts are ready as well. Unfortunately, only one. I probably should have found another video. We'll see if we find time to do a bit larger video, random video. And we can go with an interactive book and higher order questions about biomechanics. We'll see what we get. I've actually never tried something so short, so it will be fun to see what we get. For large language models, we should have some content already. These are higher order questions for large language model. We can take biomechanics first. Very short, but what did we get? So now we've had the AI suggest for the teacher some projects where you can do higher order learning on large language models, no, on biomechanics. Compose a piece of music that captures the rhythm and dynamics of human movement inspired by biomechanics. I was trying to have the students create based on the content of the video. Develop a training program for athletes that optimizes biomechanical principles to prevent injuries and improve performance. So that this is the type of higher order questions that you can have the AI suggest for you. And now we have a very short interactive book probably about biomechanics. So it has the text, the audio as a text, and then you have the video itself. And normally there would be many dots here explaining all the concepts and difficult words in the video. Here we get only one.
What is biomechanics?
So when biomechanics is mentioned, a definition is added automatically.
That's great. Can you just clarify again about smart import, please? Is it so you have to visit that and log in separately in another browser from where you are, or should just go over that little bit again, please? A question in the chat about smart import.
Yeah, the smart import is part of h5p.com, which is h5p as a service. So you can either use it there, it's a paid product, or you can use it in Moodle via LTI. And I also know that there are projects building similar things as Moodle plugins, but you will still need to subscribe to GPT to be able to use them.
So in Moodle, it will be via LTI, and obviously it's paid anyway. That's great. Thank you.
Yep. And we also have a test here. At the end, biomechanics only involves technology and science. That's probably false. How is the story of biomechanics told? In equations, steps, rotations, columns, code, and sweat? In words, sentences, and paragraphs? No. Biomechanics is transformed by the present and envisions our future for a better world in motion. that sounds true. So we get lots of questions built for us based on the content of this video. We get a glossary, but only one word here. Concept card, what is biomechanics? So the student is encouraged to think, and then they can flip the card and see if they remember what it is. We get a little quiz, true, false question, fill in the blanks, story about. Let's go for love. I don't think it's correct. It's a story about us. That was weird. Yeah. So lots of questions built for us. And then we have other types of flashcards. What is biomechanics? What is the foundation of biomechanics? Quite a lot of content built on that very, very short video. What does biomechanics encompass? And I would think that if I was actually going to use this for students, I would probably go and delete some of these things that have been made for me and just use the best parts. It seems like a bit much for that little video. And then we have a summary at the end. And we have normal interactive book here showing us how we performed on this one. So that was what we got out of the biomechanics video. And we will also have a little look at a large language model, which gives a more complete example. It's a much larger video. It's a five minutes video.
GPT or generative pre-trained transform.
So here we have many more concepts, many more difficult words.
What is a large language model?
And they're all explained.
Or an LLM.
We have a quiz in the middle, similar to what we had before. What are the three components of a large language model? And also, usually the distractors are very good. So if you don't know what this is about, it's not so easy to guess. How many ML parameters does GPT-3 have, for instance? Since this is a longer video, you also get a quiz at the end. So they will be spread out in longer videos. And again, this is the first page out of 8. So you have the glossary here. Makes more sense when you have more than one concept. You have the concept cards. What is a generative pre-trained transformer? And you have a quiz again with multiple choice, true, false, fill in the blanks. The answer to that one, million. Here you also, we didn't get this one in the previous one since it had only one, but here you get to drag the concepts to the correct definitions. I don't know what the right one is here.
Does it only work in English, Smart Import? Just to clarify, it only works in English.
Yeah, so far, but we will probably soon have it in more languages.
Thank you.
It will work best in English still because GPT and those other large language models are best in English, but will work fairly well in some of the other major languages as well. And flashcards again. What are some business applications of large language models? Create intelligent chatbots for customer services and assist in content creation. And here we have another summary. So imagine building this yourselves. I think this would quickly take a day or two. Building it on all myself, just putting the definitions of all the words in the video in the right place in the video, finding the definitions, etc., takes quite a bit of time. All of the distractors coming up with them, typing it all in, etc. It's a lot of work, and this is done in 3 minutes with Smart Import. You have a nice draft. And I think if you spend another hour on a 5-minute resource like this one, it is probably safe to to hand it out to students. So spend an hour removing things, adjusting things, and you have a really good resource in built in several times faster than you would manually, and hopefully with some good new ideas as well. So it's very, very useful, very powerful. And this development is just getting started. It's going to be better and better and better. Okay, so that was the second example. And I'll also show you quickly how you can do this with text, which is also very popular. You might have a page in Moodle, very static page, that you want to turn into an interactive resource. We love berries in H5P. So let's say this is a Moodle page and you want to add something to it, flashcards or what have you. Then you can copy the text from the Moodle page. You can go to Smart Import or a similar tool. And we have paste text here. So here you can just paste in some text that you haven't had the time to make a quiz for instance, and submit it. It's not really transcribing now, it's just turning that into the type of text that Smart Import expects. So we'll continue, and now it works exactly the same as for videos. We will analyze that text, find the central concepts, and build the same type of resources. Obviously, we can't do interactive video yet. Maybe in the future, AI will be able to. We are experimenting with it, to have AI build a video based on the text, but that isn't. It will take some time before it can do that really well. So interactive video and those video-based resources won't be options, but many of the other things like flashcards, quizzes, interactive book, higher order questions, etc., will be options for this blueberry text as well. I think our users now, we have like end of last year, we had 4 to 5 schools, universities signing up for Smart Import every week. And now it's 2 to 3 so far in January, but quite a lot are using it already. And we see that paste text is very popular. They're using paste text a lot and video a lot.
We've got a lot of questions in the chat actually precisely about Smart Import. Great interest in it. Kinds of files you can use. Does it work with podcasts? Does it work with PowerPoint slides? Do you have to do it only via LTI, or can you host it on your own H5P instance such as Moodle? A lot of, you know, just a great interest in Smart Import here in the chat.
Okay, cool. I'll try to speak to some of that. So input formats are URLs, YouTube, video, etc. For files, you can use audio files. So I think any type of audio will work really well, and we will be transcribing it and we'll be able to build the same type of resources as you've seen. A podcast should work fine. We do not do PowerPoint yet. We've experimented with it. It actually works quite well for the bad PowerPoints with lots of text, but for those that are very visual, it doesn't work so well yet. Word files, PDFs do work. You can upload them. You can use it via LTI, or you can use it from hfp.com directly and embed it to any page that accepts an embed code. So hopefully that answers some of it.
Thank you.
We'll continue with blueberry now. So here we can also go interactive book, and maybe we go a crossword. And you can also do a standalone flashcards, dialogue cards. So we can ask it to build those three. This typically takes like 10 seconds to build. So now while we've been speaking here, we made one of our Moodle pages interactive. We're building interactive resources for a static page. So this is what a crossword looks like. Don't think we have the time to try to answer all of this, so we'll just show the solution. We get euro, blueberries, huckleberries, genus, antioxidants, etc. So we quickly built a nice little entertaining resource for our blueberry page. We can add to the page, engage the students, and help them remember some key concepts. We have dialogue cards. So we can add this standalone in the middle or at the end of the page. Interactive summary would be really nice too. What's the classification of blueberries? In which hemisphere are North American native blueberry species grown commercially? We think it's North America. Not the best question. For how long have First Nations peoples of Canada consumed wild blueberries? Thousands of years, yeah. And we also get the interactive book, but the starter is textual. We see that we got some headings, the edit we should remove, edit text. And then we got a glossary for our blueberry resource. So here, typically, if you have a Moodle page about blueberries, you could choose to just replace the entire page with an interactive book. Then you would get the text on the front page. Maybe you want to add an image or two yourself. That's something we are looking at automating. And then you have a glossary here on page two. And similarly, you have the concept cards. So we got 23 concept cards based on those two, three paragraphs. We got the same type of quiz. We got drag the words, flashcards, etc. So very efficient way to get a good first draft of an interactive version of that static page. And hopefully saves us a lot of time and gives our students a resource that they can remember better and also understand better and find more interesting to work with. Okay, I think I spent a little bit more than my 40 minutes. Should we go questions? Are there questions?
The still asking about smart import, really. I don't know if you want to speak a bit more about it, but do you want to go on to more general questions now?
We could take a couple of smart imports first.
Okay, yeah. Can it handle the translation or a subtitling of a video?
So not translation, but today it's a bit stupid. It adds this reader-friendly text below the video. It doesn't add subtitles yet, but that is on top of our to-do list now. It's since we are transcribing it anyway, we definitely want to add captions to the video also.
Yeah,
so that is coming.
Can you generate a timeline activity from a text?
No, a smart import doesn't have that. I think if you tried the other method using GPT directly, it would be very, very advanced.
Yeah,
you would have to make GPT format a JSON for you, and it would be very hard.
There is an interesting general question actually about from Katerina about copyright aspects, particularly after you process a document with AI, and how would you deal with it? I mean, that's not only H5P specific, but in general using AI and copyright, I think.
Mm. Yeah, part of the reason that we do smart import so require that you have a resource already. Obviously, we could just type in a subject and have GPT create a text for us as well. But then you are in much higher copyright risk because GPT it doesn't say where it got knowledge from or the wordings. But when you upload the resource, you should have you should know what the copyright for the resource you're uploading is, and we ask GPT to use that as the truth and base everything on the resource that was uploaded to lower the risk of any copyright infringements. So that's the answer to that. I can add to it also that I know that some of our customers use Smart Import and GPT together. So they can have GPT, they can tell GPT to write six paragraphs of, let's say, blueberries again or something else. And they will copy that text into Smart Import and turn it into an interactive resource. But then their copyright risk is higher since, again, we don't know where GPT got it from.
Okay. Is Smart Import only available for schools and organizations? Some Manfred asking, I have no idea how much it would cost if I want to use it in my private Moodle site for my students. And in fact, questions about pricing. Some people have posted a link, h5p.com/pricing. If you have a different link from that, we could add that. We don't want to talk about pricing specifically here, but if there is a page on the website where people can look as to how they could purchase Smart Import, that would be very helpful.
Yeah, we are actually, if you sign up to h5p.com, Smart Import isn't there because it's very expensive for us to,
okay.
Every time it is used, it costs us $1 or even a little bit more for an average video. The transcribing is costly and the AI is costly. So, but when you sign up on h5p.com, you'll be able to talk to our staff and they can turn on Smart Import for you and tell you what the price of Smart Import is.
That's great. So sign up to h5p.com and then you can discuss that. Michael asks, is Smart Import available via API?
Not yet, but that's something we're looking at, trying to make it so that we can integrate it in the H5P plugin for Moodle, so that you will use the service to create the content, but you will host it yourself, and H5P.com will never get your student data, for instance. But it's not available today.
Okay, that's great. Also, if you can remind us again, which other languages will be integrated into Smart Import and when? From Frank, you've obviously got people whose first language isn't English who are very keen for this to happen.
Yeah, we don't have dates yet. The first languages will be, you know, French, the typical large Western ones, French, German, Spanish, at least those three will be the first, and they will be coming this year, but we don't know exactly when. We have to be, we don't give out deadlines typically because we want it to have the right quality. That's what decides when it gets released.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Looking at the time. Yes. Do keep the questions coming and I will relay them over to Svein.
I can also mention while people think of questions, we released the game map. I don't think we've sent out a newsletter yet, but if you go on h4p.org, there's a new content type called game map, which is very, very cool, where you can build maps with nodes on them, and you can decide you first have to do this activity before you can do this one. You can have some nodes require that you have a certain amount of points before they unlocked. You have the concept of lives. So every time the learners do a mistake, they lose a life. And if they lose too many, they have to start over. So it's a bit like a Super Mario map, almost gamified learning.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Seems to be becoming very popular.
There's a question about, can you do open-ended questions and short answer questions?
Fill in the blanks will be the closest one that is supported. And you can do fill in the blanks both with the first method I showed.
Yeah.
And the second one, open-ended, maybe, only true when I showed you the higher order questions.
Yeah.
Maybe that's closer, yeah.
Okay. From John, hello, John. Any general advice about training teachers to use all of this?
In terms of Smart Import, it seems to be very easy, much easier than So some of those who have smart import know when they train teachers in using H5P, they do it via smart import because they find that it's easier for them to use smart import and then go in and edit and get familiar with the authoring tool through editing something they are familiar with instead of having them start from scratch and build content. So it seems like smart import is quite easy. It's not a lot of things you can click on and do. It's just provide the content and do some reviews, and then you get a result, and then you go in and edit. So those already familiar with H5P seems to have a very easy transition into smart import.
Eric, hello, Eric. We do not have textual input mode in our Moodle H5P plugin. Are there plans to build this into the Moodle plugin?
It should be there. It should be exactly the same. So if you go in, I think you would have to have a very, very old version of interactive summary, for instance, if you don't have the textual input mode.
Perhaps you could ask that on the Moodle.org forums then, Eric, and we can have a look for you there. I am looking for some more. Lots of questions here. Outside of content creation, are there H5P tools to correct grammar or pronunciation? I think this is a general question asking about which kind of H5P tools you could use for those kind of speaking activities.
It would be speak the words and speak the word set. So on h5p.org, you find them here. Speak the word, speak the word set. You can use them to challenge the students to say things, and then there will be speech recognition that tries to correct them.
Yeah,
so
I think I've used that one. I think I've used that one myself, actually. It's good. Yes.
It's also the game map I mentioned. It looks like this.
Oh, wow. That's very impressive.
This is a very simple example. It has a lot more features than... It doesn't have to be linear, for instance. Some of these nodes can open up as you do things. So you can build really cool things with it. We're going to add... Oh, maybe we have another example here. Here is the solar system, so it's a bit cooler. So here you can have content in the beginning. I don't know if I do anything correct. So I didn't get full score, I lost a life. But I can continue. I had to do the one in the beginning first, and now it unlocked many other nodes. And also this one wasn't visible before. Now it became visible. And we see the one here requires me to get 3 points before I can unlock it. So I have to go and visit other nodes to unlock the Earth and do the tasks there. I know there's also a hidden one on the other side of the Earth that will unlock when I do the Earth one. But just make sure you download it to your Moodle and you can use this one. The authoring tool is also very cool. You can customize colors and everything. It's built by Oliver Duck in Germany. So one of our community members have contributed to this one.
Yeah, he's quite active on Moodle.org forums as well. Any news on the H5P OER hub we have from Charika? And Manfred's also asking about the H5P hub.
Yeah, that project has been almost finished for several years. I don't have an exact ETA for it. I know we are working on it, still trying to finish it. We've had consultants working on it, and now we're fixing the things they did. Hopefully in this quarter, it will be completely finished. It is possible to populate it now. You can turn it on in the Moodle plugin, the H5P. I don't think it's in the core version of H5P, but in the H5P plugin for Moodle, you can go into settings and enable a beta version of the hub, and both search the hub for content and populate the hub with content.
Okay.
But the official release hopefully this quarter.
Yes, I just wanted to remind people actually that if you are using H5P and Moodle, we do have an H5P forum on Moodle.org, where you can ask H5P questions specifically related to your Moodle implementation, either Moodle H5P in core, as it has been in recent versions, or the plugin if you have an older version of Moodle. There is a question. I'm not quite sure what you mean, Drew. I'm sorry if I'm not pronouncing your name correctly. Will there be an offline option with H5P content and not an offline H5P author tool, because there are a couple, but offline H5P content? So do you mean if you're, for instance, on the Moodle mobile app and then you go offline, you can still access it? Like H5P? Do you understand the question? Sorry, Svein?
Yeah, I think that if you're using the core version of Moodle,
yes,
you'll be able to use H5P offline. I'm not sure what happens to the grades. We also have on the roadmap Android, iOS, and Windows apps for playing H5P files offline, and with XAPI support and other features. So when we get to that, we will be building plugins or apps for the most common platforms that can play H5P files, probably edit them too. And then it will be, if you answer them offline and go online, the app will be able to sync your results to the platform you're using. Yeah.
Yes. Well, that's how activities work with the Moodle mobile app as well. Yes, Drew, if you have the Moodle mobile app, for instance, you can do certain quizzes and other Moodle activities offline. And then, as Svein says, when you can get back online, it will sync your submission and the grades to the website. Yes. I've got a very technical question here, which I don't understand, so I'm just going to repeat it to you, Svein. Is there a way we can feed the smart import with contents from our Moodle's RESTful API, given a URL? We mentioned API before, but if you can understand and elaborate on that.
Yeah, I think I understand today that wouldn't be possible. We would have to add the support for it. We can take URLs for smart import, but then we expect a typical web page with content on it that we can scrape. So it would be a nice thing to have, that we had an endpoint you could send content to and trigger smart import to turn it into interactive content.
Thank you. Okay, we've time for just, if there are any other very, very urgent questions, I think we've time for maybe just one or two at the most, and then I believe Sandra is going to wrap up this really excellent session. Someone also mentioned Moodlebox, by the way. If you're in an environment where you can't use the internet at all, then Moodlebox is a great solution for having your own Moodle and all the functionality, including H5P, internally in a physical building there. We're getting some thank yous now. So Sandra, I think that's probably time to wind it up. I know you have a few other things to talk about.
Yes, thank you, Mary. And thank you so much, Vin, for this interesting session and for everyone for asking those very good questions during the session. It's been a really interactive session. I hope you enjoyed it. So if you have enjoyed this session, we'd love you to consider getting involved further and help us grow by contributing to the development of Moodle Academy. You can do this by visiting our Get Involved course, which you'll find on the front page of the Moodle Academy site. You can suggest ideas for new webinars and courses, and you can vote ideas that have been suggested by others already. We're always on the lookout for community members to help present webinars and co-create short online courses. And we'd love your help making Moodle Academy more inclusive. So if you're able to, please jump in to our Translate Moodle Academy course and get started with helping us translate our courses and webinars into other languages. And of course, please help spread the word about Moodle Academy by telling your colleagues about the courses we offer and the events we run. When you complete the course, you will earn a badge. You will also receive a badge if you present a Moodle Academy webinar like today's session. Educators might like to think about getting involved with a Moodle Educator certificate. You can take the Are You Ready for the MEC quiz, and one of our certified service providers will support you through the certification process. Thank you for joining us today. I hope you find this useful, and I hope to see you on the Moodle Academy course forums and in our coming webinars. If you have any further questions, you can write them on the discussion forum in the affiliated course on the Moodle, for the Moodle community to answer. So thank you again for joining us today. And thank you to Svein for being here. And we hope to see you soon at future Moodle Academy webinars. Goodbye.